Do you know what this invitation is all about?
Unfortunately not. Seems as if we're both clueless.
Good evening. Excuse me, is this the right place for the presentation?
Welcome, my distinguished attendees. I am pleased that you are all here. Joanne Kepler, court astronomer and mathematician. Wilhelmina Wollaston, physicist at the Royal Society. And of course, Tycho Brahe, astronomer to the Danish king. But where are my manners? Please, let me introduce myself. I am Virgil Brooks, your host.
But
I have gathered you here today to make an announcement that I am sure will be of great interest to you. Listen carefully. The day after tomorrow, time will come to a complete standstill. The stars have already stopped moving.
How is that possible?
Don't worry about that yet. Until then, be my guests. You have to stay for dinner.
Welcome, Mr. Brahe. Mr. Brooks is already awaiting you.
A disconcerting eye made of glass. Is it staring back at me? A noble little sofa.
Mr. Brahe, welcome to my office. Feel free to look around.
I can't make any sense of it. What is that strange machine over here?
Oh, that. That is my cognitive enhancer. I bought it once from a very tiny man in Amsterdam. He claimed that it would boost cognitive abilities, and that it would emit a high-pitched steam whistle sound when the user spends too much time pondering. But I realized that it does absolutely nothing besides whistling at completely random times.
Oh, I'm sorry for your mispurchase.
The seller better pray I never come back to Amsterdam. At least it looks fancy.
A pencil drawing is hanging on the wall. It's a drawing of an impressive organ.
I learned to play that instrument during my time in Prague.
You seem to be a man with many talents, Mr. Brooks.
Dedication, Mr. Brahe. I am a very dedicated man.
A pencil drawing is hanging on the wall. It shows a huge obelisk.
That's a story for another time.
I can't make any sense of it. What's special about this teapot?
It's one of my most precious belongings. A device I developed all by myself. When pouring something in, it distinguishes between different types of tea and holds the temperature at the perfect level. Earl Grey or Darjeeling, peppermint or matcha. Everything is possible with this special teapot.
There is some kind of energy flowing through it. There is some kind of energy flowing through it.
No, no. That's just how this old mechanism works. No need to think about it any further.
That's a peculiar grandfather clock.
No, no. That's just an old clock that doesn't even tell the correct time. No need to think about it any further.
I can't make any sense of it. What is that strange machine over here?
That's my spiritual clone machine. It allows me to duplicate each and every human on Earth.
That's impressive. Does it really work?
Sure. But there is one drawback to it. If the cloned person is noted by anyone, he or she will just vanish into thin air. The clone just disappears at eyesight.
Very interesting.
I think you've seen everything interesting in here, and also some ordinary things like this grandfather clock with its insignificant glass tube. What do you like most? Is it the teapot?
I
bet it's the teapot. But now, Mr. Brahi, I will turn my attention to the upcoming meal. There are some topics to be discussed with Declan. Declan.
Mr. Brooks.
Report the current status.
Got it.
Well, I just finished the vichyssoise as an hors d'oeuvre.
Got it.
Sounds delicious. Now hurry up.
Very well, sir. Mr. Brooks is already awaiting.
Declan.
Mr. Brooks.
What took you so long? Didn't I tell you that I want you to react quicker?
Very well, sir.
That?
Oh. That was just George.
Declan.
An old plush teddy.
October 23rd. The moon hangs low tonight, casting eerie shadows across the mansion. Mr. Ambrose Fairchild, that peculiar owlish visitor, haunts my thoughts. He showed an unusual interest in my astronomical studies, and today I observed him manipulating the grandfather clock. What purpose could he have for such inquiries? I've allowed him, along with his timid butler Declan and the taciturn George, to stay in my mansion. Unsettling events leave me filled with dread and suspicion. Time itself seems to wane and wax at Mr. Fairchild's whims, for the clocks throughout the house keep strange, inconsistent hours. October 26th. Another sleepless night has passed, and the mansion feels like a prison. Mr. Ambrose Fairchild taunts me with cryptic knowledge, and his visits to my study grow more frequent. Last night, under the ghastly glow of the full moon, I beheld the true extent of his sinister influence. October 27th. The final entry, dear diary, for I know not if I shall survive this night. The clock strikes midnight, and I pen these words with trembling hands. Tonight I shall confront Mr. Ambrose Fairchild in the moonlit garden where the boundary between reality and nightmare blurs. Armed with a dagger, it is the only means to cut the sinister thread that binds him to my existence. If you find this diary, pray for my soul. For I fear I may be lost to the darkness that surrounds me. Farewell, dear diary. And may you find a safer haven than my own tortured mind.
Mr. Brahi, what are you doing in here?
I read your diary.
I am very disappointed that you have invaded my privacy. And I am even more disappointed that Declan let this happen. I was probably too lenient with him. I'll keep an eye on you. Both.
All right. Let's try this. But I should be very careful with such a powerful device. Oh!
Suspicious. Declan.
Not interested in this bottle. That's a decent selection of wine. This one is labeled tap water. There's a warning sign with a skull and crossbones on it. Oh, that was me. Hello, Declan.
How may I be of service?
Aren't you supposed to cook dinner?
In all modesty, I am excellent at multitasking. The food is on the stove.
I'd like to talk to you about George.
All I know is that Mr. Brooks helped him at a time when George didn't see any future for himself. And now it is claimed that George is the future of Mr. Brooks. But I don't know what that means. It's just what Mr. Brooks says.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Mr. Brooks seems to be quite harsh.
No, no. He is an honorable and very generous employer.
See you later.
Have a nice evening, Mr. Brahi.
Declan. Let's have dinner. Delicious. Isn't it, Miss Wollaston?
Indeed. This meal is a celebration of exquisite tastes.
I agree. The taste is so rich and indulgent.
Declan really surpassed himself here.
Makes my hunger go away.
Yes. Thank you, George.
Mr. Brooks, I'd like to ask you something. I never heard of you before you invited us here. What's your story?
I've become pretty reclusive recently. But before I moved here, I lived in many places of this planet. Never stayed for a long time. I am always eager to learn, and always eager to experience the beautiful things in life.
I can't help but notice you seem to have the appearance of an owl.
Oh dear, it's getting late.
About George. We hadn't had time to talk to each other so far.
Yes, that's because he's very busy at the moment.
About the time coming to a standstill. Wollaston and I experienced that we cannot leave the mansion.
It's like time passes slower the farther you get away from the mansion.
That sounds quite unsettling.
What will happen when time stops passing?
I assume that everything and everyone will be locked in their current position, not being able to move or talk or feel forever.
What can we do to stop this?
Oh, if only I knew. But as far as I am aware, there's no way for humans to influence the passage of time.
There needs to be something we can do.
Well, go on and try.
Who is supposed to sit in the empty chair?
The unoccupied chair is for Declan. I allow him to eat our leftovers. If there are any, that is.
Mr. Brohi, if you don't mind, may I ask you something?
Of course.
It's about your golden nose. How did it happen?
Miss Wollaston, this is such a rude question. Asking someone about their unusual appearance. You must be embarrassing, Mr. Brahe.
No, it's fine.
You are mistaken, Mr. Brahe. It is clearly not appropriate.
Oh, dear.
All right. That was a hard day for everybody. With a blissful meal as the crescendo. Have a good night, my distinguished guests. At the Owl Observatory. Wishlist now. You have to stay for dinner. Declan.
Mr. Brooks.
Got it.
I just want you to get back to work, Declan.
Very well, sir.
Declan. Declan.
Mr. Brooks.
What took you so long?
Got it.
Didn't I tell you that I want you to react quicker?
Very well, sir.
I don't want Mr. Brooks to see that I
Declan.
Use his clone machine.
Mr. Brooks.
I just thought about the delicious black pudding you cooked last week.
Well?
It was extraordinary.
Thank you, Mr. Brooks.
Mr. Brahe. My spiritual clone machine went missing. Do you happen to know anything about it?
I...
Well, I don't want to make any accusations here, but rest assured that I do not tolerate hostile behavior in my house.
All right, let's try this. But I should be very careful with such a powerful device. Oh!
Suspicious. Declan.
Oh, that was me.
Declan.
You are sleeping in my room upstairs.
Let's have dinner. Thank you, George.
Mr. Brooks, I'd like to ask you something. I can't help but notice you seem to have the appearance of an owl.
Oh dear, it's getting late.
I'd really like to know why you are an owl.
Oxygen-inhaling species? Well, that's an odd question, don't you think, Mr. Brahe?
No, really. Please tell me, why do you look like an owl?
Organ player? Well, I learned to play that instrument during my time in Prague.
I'm intrigued. What led to you becoming, you know, an owl?
An ostrich? Well, now you're getting silly. I am clearly not an ostrich, as everybody can see.
Oh dear.
Why are you an owl?
Obelisk enjoyer? Well, That's a story for another time.
It seems to me as if you look like an owl.
Onion connoisseur? Well, I simply can't get enough of their incredible taste. Whether they're caramelized to a sweet golden perfection in a savory dish, or adding a satisfying crunch to a fresh salad, I'm absolutely enthusiastic about their versatility and flavor. Onions bring a unique depth and richness to so many of my favorite recipes. From the zingy red onions in a tangy salsa, to the mellow, comforting sweetness of sautéed onions in a French onion soup. So, whether it's crispy fried onions on a green bean casserole, or the aromatic base for a hearty stew, onions are a true culinary marvel, and I can't help but savor every delicious moment with them.
Yes, that was exactly what I wanted to know.
Any time, Mr. Brahi.
About George. Are you also a scientist, George?
I am a lawyer.
He's my lawyer.
Do you also live here, at Mr. Brooks' house?
Yes, he does.
That's pretty unusual for a lawyer to live with his client, isn't it?
It is just the way I want it to be.
And do you want to live here, George?
I live here, at Mr. Brooks' house. I am his future.
Enough, George. From tomorrow onwards, you are suspended from having dinner with us. And, Mr. Brahi, that is none of your concern.